So, reminder of just a couple of things. You remember the section of the Jordan River that was dried up, we determined it was about 16 miles of river. And remember roughly what the population of the Israelites that were crossing the river was, probably about 1.5 million, something like that. So this is a huge miracle. We're not going to go over all that stuff again. We're going to look at two aspects that are highlighted in this chapter. One is this whole idea, which we talked about a little bit last week, of memorials. You know, they took the 12 stones and they made memorials. This, as we talked about last week, by way of review, because this leads into one thing I want to mention here, and that is teaching our children. Teaching our children is mentioned twice in this chapter, verse 7, and then again in verses 20 through 22, in this short 24 verses, in the context of this memorial. Okay, so teaching your kids is a big deal. Can we turn this down? Because it's distracting. It's distracting me, and I'm guessing it's probably distracting you as well.
Yeah.
Okay. So memorials are a big deal because, as we mentioned last week, as it happens, we tend to forget. Even miracles that are happening daily, the children of Israel forgot. So Exodus 12:14, so this day shall be to you a memorial. That's referring to, as we talked about, that's referring to the Passover, right? This is about Passover as well. It shall be as a sign to you on your hand, as a memorial between your eyes. That's again referring to Passover. The death of the firstborn of all the Egyptians. Okay, so that was a memorial, and they were to do this every year because it was a memorial. By the way, I think, I didn't actually check this, but he mentions that it was the 10th day of the first month, and in here, when the children of Israel crossed the Jordan, and I believe that was the day that the Passover lamb was chosen. And then Passover began on the 14th, because remember, God changed the months when he instituted Passover. He said this month, which was April, you know, that's what they were in at the time. He said this month will be the first of months to you. He changed it. So anyway, I think, but I'd have to double check that. But I think this was right at Passover time, right at April, and it makes sense because it also says that the Jordan River overflowed its banks, you know, in the springtime. So this is springtime when this is occurring. Hey, so let's go on with memorials. In Deuteronomy 6, 8 through 9, you shall bind them as a sign in your hand. They shall be as frontlets between your eyes. And if you remember, we used that as an example, that the Israelites actually took Deuteronomy 6, 8, and 9 literally. They actually bound them little boxes with scripture pieces on their arm, on their head, as frontlets between their eyes, okay, on their hands. And as front, and they still do this. If you go to the Wailing Wall in Israel, you will see people dressed like that. You'll see rabbis with that thing on their head, with those things on their arms. They put them on their arms, on their biceps, because they want to be close to their heart. So they still do that. They still take that literally. And I'm not saying they shouldn't. I'm just saying they took it literally. Those are memorials. Those are examples of memorials. Like we're looking at the 12 stones here. It's a memorial. It's to remind us of what God did. As we read this in Joshua chapter 4, though, also, the memorial is not just for the generation in which it occurred. It was specifically to teach your kids. It specifically says, when your kids ask, what's this? This is what you tell them, okay? And it says it twice, again, in these short 24 verses, says it twice. So let's look a little bit more at that. Joshua called the 12 men, cross over. Then you shall answer them that the waters of the Jordan were, let's go under there. According to the number of the tribes of Israel, then you shall answer them that the waters of the Jordan were cut off before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. Every time this memorial came up, it was going to be an opportunity for them to rehearse what God did. Okay? Now, I mean, the question arises, do we have, as individuals, as individual Christian men, as heads of our households, as fathers to our children, or grandchildren, because it references the grandchildren too, do we have habits like that? Do we have memorials like that that are going to evoke a question about, why do you pray in the morning? Why do you read the Bible every day? Or whatever it is, whatever it is. We talked about, you may remember the mezuzah, you know, the thing you're supposed to put on your doorposts. I was reading about that in a book. You may remember Pastor David at times mentioning a fellow by the name of Alfred Edersheim. He talks about Alfred Edersheim's work. He wrote a book called Sketches of Jewish Social Life in the Days of Christ. It's a great little book. Anyway, he talks about the Jewish teaching of children, and we'll go into that a little bit more. But he talks about the fact that even before a child could talk, you would be holding the child, and you would go in the door, and you would go to the mezuzah, and you'd touch the mezuzah, and you'd kiss your hand, and you'd usually recite a small portion of scripture. Now, before the kid could talk, he saw you do that. And he sees you do it every time you go in the door. So eventually, he's going to ask you, why do you do that? Okay? Which gives you a chance to witness to what God did, which gives you a chance to witness to God's word, which gives you a chance to tell what's in that and why you do that. Okay? So that's, again, mezuzah is just an example of a memorial, like the 12 stones, like the Passover, like we talked about communion. It's a memorial. 1 Corinthians 11 talks about the fact that when we celebrate communion, we do show or announce or kind of evangelize the Lord's death till he come. Okay? It gives us a chance to witness to that. And we talked about other things practical about the communion, but we don't need to go into that now. And then the other place it's mentioned is in Joshua 4, 20 to 22. Those 12 stones with the children of Jordan, Joshua ben Gilgal, he spoke to the children of Israel saying, when your children ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what are these stones? Once again, you have a chance to witness. That's what the memorials were for. Now let's talk a little bit about, let's talk a little bit about teaching your children, because the family, take your Bibles and go to 1 Timothy. We'll do a little bit of page flipping tonight. I apologize. I hope you have either a digital medium or a paper Bible. If you don't, great, listen in. But 1 Timothy chapter 3. I've got to step back here in a little bit because I can't see it this otherwise. 1 Timothy chapter 3. We had some new deacons installed recently, right, in the church. And we've had, elders installed. So 1 Timothy chapter 3 talks about the qualifications of a deacon or an elder. We're just going to sort of read through a couple verses here. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. I'm reading King James. I'll translate the these and the thous when I can, but otherwise you got to bear with me. Okay? This is a true saying. If a man desired the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach, not given to wine, no striker, not greedy of filthy lucre, but patient, not a brawler, not covetous, one that ruleth well his own household, having his children in subjection with all gravity. Now, skip down a little bit more. Likewise, verse 8, must the deacons be grave, not double-tongued, not given to much wine, not greedy of filthy lucre. And let's skip down even more. Verse 12, let the deacons be the husbands of one wife, ruling their children and their own houses well. Okay? So the qualifications of deacons or elders involved ruling their houses well, having their children in subjection with all gravity. The reason for that is the family is the basic subunit of spiritual growth. The family is the basic subunit of the spread of God's word, okay, from father, son, to kids. It's also from generation to generation. That's why we read in Joshua in 4 through 7 and in verses 20 to 22. That is why it says, you tell your children and you tell your children's children. The Shema says the same thing. It's the transmission from one generation to another. The family was supposed to do that. Okay? So we, as husbands, fathers, we're supposed to really be, we are integral in that word being passed from one generation to the next, which is why teaching your kids is so important. Now, this is just a sidelight, a little geeky, but bear with me. The Hebrew language has actually 8 or 9 different words to describe children. One is just the word son. It's the word you might, like Benjamin, son of my right hand. The word Ben is a Hebrew word for son, right? And then they have all these other ones, too. A Yeled is a newborn. Okay, this go in order of age. A Yonek is a suckling. He or she starts to breastfeed. And then there's an Olel, he or she starts to actually take solid food. They're asking bread. They had a word for that. A Gamel is one who was weaned. In Jewish culture, weaning was about at the end of 2 years, and they had a feast to celebrate it. Okay, so weaning was a big deal. Now, the reason I'm pointing these out is not just to know Greek or Hebrew words, which makes no difference whatsoever. It is simply because to them, children were a big deal. They observed and had names for all the stages, okay? It's like you may have heard in the past, which I'm not sure is true, but like Eskimos have 14 words for snow because to them it's a big deal to know exactly what kind of snow it is. Well, for the Hebrew people, knowing what exactly what kind of stage they were in, where they were, what characterized that stage, they named every one. A taff is one who clings to his mother, but he's kind of going out and back. You know, they'll go a little ways, and then they'll come hide behind mom, and then they'll go a little ways, and come, and that's this, right? An elem, becoming firm and strong. A na'ar, one who shakes himself free. You know, like early, we would call it maybe early adolescence. He's starting to gain freedom. And then a bakur is a ripened one. He's not quite the warrior age, but close. He's not a gibor, not a mighty man, not, you know, over 20 and can fight, but he's close to that. He's on his way to that. Now, I thought this was interesting. Again, this is just a sidelight. This isn't biblical. This is, you may have heard, again, Pastor David mentioned something called the Mishnah, okay? In Jewish culture, the written word was not the only thing to them that was authoritative. Like the Catholic Church, you may know that the Catholic Church, they had, you know, had the Bible, but then you had all the palpal traditions and all the palpal bulls and all the palpal this and that. That was all included in what they considered to be church doctrine. The Jewish people actually had a similar thing. Not only the Old Testament, the Hebrew Old Testament, but something called the Mishnah. It was like 200, these are what rabbis said about the Bible. And it was essentially oral tradition, which they felt went back to Moses. And they equated it in authority with the Hebrew Old Testament. Okay, I'm only pointing this out because it reflects Jewish culture, not because it's divine. I'm not saying it's inspired. I'm only saying it kind of points out Jewish culture. And there's a couple of interesting things about it that I wanted to point out in light of teaching kids. Okay, so this is a quote from this guy, Rabbi Yehuda, right? This is from the Mishnah. It's divided up into chapters, and it deals with certain subjects. So this deals with kids. Okay, so he says, at 5 years of age, reading the Bible. That's what they were supposed to be doing at 5 years of age. At 10 years, learning the Mishnah. At 13 years, bound to the commandments. Remember, 13 was when they had a bar mitzvah, right? They became a son or daughter of the law, so to speak. At 15 years, the study of the Talmud. At 18 years, marriage. Remember, in the time of Christ, Mary was probably in her early teens when she gave birth to Jesus. Because they got married a whole lot year earlier than we do. Okay, marriage, at 20, the pursuit of a trade or business. At 30, full vigor. At 40, maturity of reason, hopefully. At 50, for counsel. At 60, commencement of agedness. At 70, gray age. At 80, advanced old age. At 90, bowed down. At 100, as if he were dead and gone and taken from the earth. But for 5 years, they're going to just read the Bible. For another 5 years, they're going to just learn the Mishnah. Now, what a child has to learn in school now is a whole lot more complicated than it was then. I'm not suggesting we use that as a model. I'm only suggesting, look at the importance of learning God's word that they put on educating their kids. Look at the time they put into that, not only in the home, but in their Jewish schools, which they were required, by the way, at a certain age to send their kids to school, just like they are in the United States, just like we are. Anyway, Deuteronomy 6, 6, and 7, this is part of the Shema, just by way of review. These words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children. Shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. And then it's a parallel. It's you may remember the mezuzah that I mentioned. These two passages of scripture, Deuteronomy 11, 13 through 21, Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 9, I believe, were the written on parchment, were the pieces of parchment that were in the mezuzah. When you were kissing it, these were the portions of scripture that were in there. Okay. So Deuteronomy 11, 18 to 21, therefore you shall lay up these words of mine in your heart and in your soul and bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall teach them to your children, speaking of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates, that your days and the days of your children may be multiplied in the land of which the Lord swore to your fathers to give them, like the days of the heavens above the earth. Now, Again, emphasis of teaching your kids, how important that was. Think about the fact that God Almighty, and we'll mention this a little bit later with another aspect that we'll look at in Joshua 4, but think about the fact that God Almighty, who spoke into being everything that you see, who spoke into being you, who just said, let us make man, and in a day it was done, right? Or let there be light, and it was, which we still don't understand. We don't understand what it is, but he just says it, and it's there. He could choose lots of ways to teach kids, but he chose for us to do it. And think about that. Just think about the responsibility and the privilege it is to teach kids or grandkids, okay? It also includes grandkids. Let's look at, we looked at that already. Yeah, we looked at that already. So along these lines, just a couple of sort of conclusions. What, first of all, are we teaching our kids? And I say what because it's not whether we're teaching our kids. We are teaching our kids. Just like, you know, if you're a Christian, you are witnessing to the gospel. The question is not, are you witnessing? The question is it a good witness or not? You are teaching your kids. Even if you're teaching them nothing, you're teaching them something that's not biblical or godly. You're teaching your kids. The question is, what are you teaching your kids? And also, the other thing I wanted to mention is, it's not like you gotta be a Bible scholar to teach your kids the Bible. You don't. And you don't even have to do all of it yourself. You just have to make sure it gets done. That's all. It can be something as simple as reading the Bible with them and praying with them on a regular basis. It doesn't have to be rocket science. It can be, if you're not comfortable with that, I mean, as a physical therapist over the last 21 years, right, I have run into people who can't read. You know, I'll ask them to sign a consent form so that I can work with them. They'll put an X there. I'll say, do you know how to read? No, I never got to school. Or I finished the third grade. You know, if you're not comfortable with that, then just make sure it gets done. You know, somebody, a relative, church. But please understand, those are all substitutes for what you can teach your kids. And what your wife, you know, what the home does for teaching your kids. Everything is a substitute for you. You can make sure it gets done if you just feel you can't do it yourself. But those are additions. Those are adjuncts, okay? Like children's ministry here, great as it is, great as a job as everybody does, it doesn't replace the home. You've got to teach your kids. God gave us the responsibility. He didn't say in Deuteronomy, when we read in Deuteronomy 6, he didn't say, take your kids to Sunday school. That it says, you teach your children. You diligently teach your children. Okay, that's what it's supposed to be. The reason I point that out is that is an emphasis in Joshua chapter 4. It's mentioned twice in 24 verses in the context of crossing a river with a million people. He makes sure with that memorial that they know they're supposed to teach their kids and says it twice. So clearly it's an emphasis. Okay, again, the family is the basic subunit for the passage of the word from mom and dad to the first generation and then to the grandchildren as well, so that it goes from generation to generation. The family is the subunit, not the church. Okay? The family is the subunit. Now, I'm not saying churches aren't great, but the family is the subunit. And it's important that we understand that. And the other thing I thought of too is, do we ever... I mean, you know, so my kids, and you may have older kids than I do, but my kids are 28, 25, and 21, right? So I think I was deceived sort of into thinking that kind of they get in college or they get maybe out of college and they're married, that you don't have a responsibility to really teach them anymore because they're, you know, they're kind of on their own. They're taking their jobs. They're taking care of themselves. That's not true because I am never not their father. I always have that responsibility. Now, it may not be of the same character as when they were small and I was sitting in my house and we were actually reading the Bible together. It may not be that way. But I always have that responsibility because I'm never not their father. I am, as long as they live, I'm going to be their dad. So I still have that responsibility. To the degree that I can do it, I still have that responsibility. And then in the context of this, you know, accountability, I mean, we're accountable as Christians for lots of things. As men, husbands, fathers, deacons, elders, as Christians, we're responsible for a lot of things. But in the context of teaching kids, Romans 14:12 came to mind, which is that what it says right there. So then each of us shall give account of himself to God. So did we teach them? Did we read the Bible with them? Did we pray with them? Did they learn any of this from us? Or did they have to learn it somewhere else? Okay. I think it's important that we're very careful about that. Deuteronomy, where you read the Shema, where we read Deuteronomy 11. Deuteronomy as a book were Moses' last words. Okay. The reason it's called Deuteronomy, the word means second law. Okay. The law is given like in Exodus, Leviticus, not so much in Numbers. Numbers is more of a historical book. But by the time you get to Deuteronomy, it's after the 40 years, right? It's before Moses is going to go up and die in Deuteronomy 34. He goes up on a mountaintop and dies. Those are his last words. Look at the emphasis they put on teaching your kids, because otherwise it dies. Christianity is not passed on. Okay. Now, everybody up. So let's see, what should we do this time? Jumping jacks? What do you say? Come on. 10 jumping jacks, everybody. 2, 3, 4, 5. Nobody's jumping. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Good. Okay, now handshake and hug or something. Talk to somebody. Say hello. How are you, sir? Good to see you. Good to see you.
Things for the children, Hebrews.
Oh, sure, absolutely.
Email them to me.
Yeah, I'll give you the email the whole chapter of what he said. Yeah, but I will. I absolutely will. Yeah.
I'm gonna use them. I got something.
Absolutely. Sounds good. Sounds good. Let's call this the meet and greet part of the fellowship. Hey Jack, how are you? Good to see you.
What's the Shema?
The Shema is Deuteronomy 6:4-9. And it's called the Shema because that's the first Hebrew word. The Hebrew word Shema means listen. So he starts out the passage in chapter 4, says, "Hear, O Israel, listen." You know, so that's what the Shema is. S-H-E-M-A, which is a transliteration of the Hebrew word. That's all that is. Yeah.
There's another word, S-H-E-M-A-T, and that has to do with
Shabbat?
Shema.
I'm not sure about that one. I'd have to look that one up. I don't know about that.
Oh.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I'd have to look at that. I'm not sure.
That's why I was like,
sounds good. Sounds good. We can look at it later if you'd like. All right, sir. Good to see you. Okay, let's go back to Joshua chapter 4. Thank you, gentlemen. Okay, so the next thing I wanted to look at here was specifically is Joshua chapter 4, verse 14. I believe it's verse 14. And let's just read that verse again. And this is the other thing that stood out to me in this chapter, looking over it a second time. And it says, on that day, Joshua chapter 4, verse 14, on that day the Lord magnified Joshua in the sight of all Israel, and they feared him as they feared Moses all the days of his life. Now, the only reason that stood out to me is that, okay, so... So we're talking about the God of the universe, right, that speaks everything again into existence in 6 days. And we'll read a little bit of Exodus 3 and 4, but when God first appeared to Moses in the desert, he spoke audibly, and there was a burning bush, so there was a physical evidence that God was there. So God can speak out loud. There are multiple records when you read about the wilderness wanderings and when the tabernacle was written, like we read Numbers chapter 12 with Miriam and Aaron questioning Moses' authority. God comes down directly to them and speaks to them directly, not by way of Moses. He just talks to them directly. He calls them out. He talks to them right there. So God can speak, communicate directly to mankind if he wants to do that, right? But here in Joshua, and then this references the fact that he did this with Moses, he chose to need men. He chose to do that. He has chosen to need us, like Jesus did with the disciples, right? You go and make disciples of all nations. Now, God is infinitely diversified. He can communicate to human beings however he wants to do it. He could have gone directly to Pharaoh. He didn't have to have Moses do it. But he chose to have Moses do it. We'll read it in Exodus 3. It's just, if you have never read Exodus 3 and 4, they're absolutely hilarious. And they're tremendous learning, but they're just great records. So the point is, God has chosen to need us. He has chosen to do that when he didn't have to do that. He's chosen to say, okay, I need deacons. I need elders. Okay, I need you guys to lead the body of Christ. I need you to do that. By the way, deacons, you probably know this, or maybe you know this, but the word deacons comes from a Greek word meaning run errands. That's what a deacon is supposed to do, run errands. Now, elders do that too, mind you. However, that's what a deacon means. You run errands. You do what has to be done. You go get this, you go get that, whatever it is. That's what you do. So, let's look at Exodus 3 and 4. Let's take your Bibles, if you would, whatever Bibles you're choosing to use, and look at Exodus chapter 3 to give you a little bit of background, not a lot of background, because we're literally just going to read through these chapters. There's not going to be a lot of comment. We're just going to read the chapters. Exodus chapter 3. To give you a little background, Moses tried to sort of help the children of Israel sort of on his own when he still lived in Egypt. He was brought up in Egypt. And he, in that context, he killed an Egyptian. He was found out. He flees. He goes to the wilderness. He's in the wilderness for 40 years, right? Taking care of the, and this, we pick it up here, and he's taking care of the flocks of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian, right? So he's in the wilderness for 40 years, and that's where we're picking this up. So that's how long he's been away from the children of Israel, away from Egypt, on his own, taking care of flocks in the desert. So we're just going to read. And I'm going to be reading KJV. So, now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. Moreover, he, God, said, I am the God of thy father, of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land, and a large unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore, and I will send you unto Pharaoh, that you may bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. What's Moses' response? And Moses said unto God, Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh? Now, the reason we're reading this passage is God has chosen to need men. God has chosen to call men to leadership, whether it's in a marriage, in a family, in a church, as an elder or a deacon, as an assisting pastor or pastor, senior pastor, whatever it is, he's called you to some kind of leadership, right? There are always going to be sort of a series of excuses that we use. Exodus 3 and 4 are great examples of these excuses. The first one we'll always ask is, who am I, right? And God's response to that, which we'll just read in verse 12, and he said, Certainly I will be with you, and this shall be a token unto thee that I have sent you. When you have brought forth the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God upon this mountain. Moses said unto God, Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The God of your fathers hath sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, What is his name? What shall I say unto them? Second question. First question is, who am I, right? Who am I to fill any kind of a leadership, any role with God? So that's the first question. Second question, who are you? Because that's the next question he asks. Okay, great. I go there and say that God sent me, but who are you? Well, who am I going to say sent me? And that was Moses' next question. Let's read God's response to that. Verse 14, and God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you. And God said moreover unto Moses, thus shall you say unto the children of Israel, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob, hath sent me unto you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial unto all generations. This is, by the way, where the name Jehovah originates. And the word Jehovah in Hebrew means, I will be what I will be. That's what the name means. Okay? In other words, God would be the God he needed to be for the situation. He would become what he needed to become. So when we ask the question, who am I? God's response is, I'm going to be with you. Okay? When we ask the question, who are you? He's going to be what he needs to be for you. Now, whatever the situation is, he's going to be what he needs to be. Remember, we read in Ephesians 3:10 last week, God's infinitely diversified, manifold wisdom. He can do anything he wants to, whenever he wants to, in whatever way he wants to. Okay. So let's keep reading. Verse 15, I'm sorry, I think we read that. Verse 16, go and gather the elders of Israel together and say unto them, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, appeared unto me saying, I have surely visited you and seen that which is done to you in Egypt. Now, I think we're going to skip down a couple of verses here. Yeah. Let's skip down to, so that was like the first two sort of excuses. You know, in other words, Moses' response to God saying, I'm going to send you to rescue the children of Israel. He says, who am I? Then he says, who are you? Let's pick it up in chapter 4, where we see a little more of Moses' response. Moses answered and said, but behold, they will not believe me, nor hearken unto my voice, for they will say, the Lord hath not appeared unto thee. And the Lord said unto him, what is that in your hand? And he said, a rod. And he said, just imagine the tone of Moses' voice. When God says to you, what's that in your hand? A rod. Just think about God Almighty talking audibly to him with a burning bush in the background, burning but not consumed, just keeps burning. And God is having a conversation with Moses. And by the way, if this were not an inspired record, why would you put this in here? This is not glorifying to Moses at all. It doesn't make Moses look good. Moses just has excuse after excuse. Well, wait a minute. Who am I? Wait a minute. Who are you? They're not going to believe me. And it gets better. So, anyway, great inspired record. Verse 3, and he said, cast it on the ground. And he cast it on the ground, and it became a serpent, and Moses fled from before it. And the Lord said unto Moses, put forth your hand and take it by the tail. Now, you would never do that with a snake, right? You would never do that. You would never grab a snake by the tail. You would always grab it by the head. But God says, take it by the tail. And he put forth his hand and caught it, and it became a rod in his hand, that they may believe that the Lord God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, has appeared unto you. Let's see now. Let's skip down one or two more here. Yeah. Let's go to verse 10. Yeah. Verse 10, Moses said unto the Lord, O my Lord, I am not eloquent, neither heretofore nor since you have spoken unto thy servant, but I am slow of speech and of a slow tongue. So, I think I have that here. Yeah, they will not believe me. God's response to that, let's just read. God's response, verse 11, and the Lord said unto me, who has made man's mouth? Or who makes the deaf, the dumb, deaf, seeing, or blind? Have not I the Lord? Now therefore go, and I will be with your mouth, and teach you what you shall say. And last excuse, verse 13. And he said, Moses said, O my Lord, send, I pray you, by the hand of him who thou wilt send. Very simply, he's saying, please send somebody else. That's the bottom line. He finally gets to it. Please just send somebody else. But God's response to that is, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against Moses, and he said, is not Aaron the Levite your brother? I know that he can speak well. And also, behold, he comes forth to meet you. And when he sees you, he will be glad in his heart. So he sends both of them. This reminded me also, you may remember when Paul is converted on the road to Damascus, right? So he goes to Damascus. Paul's blind. He's there for like 3-4 days, right? Fasting, doesn't know what's going on. So Jesus, and it was Jesus, it says Jesus, appears to, who, you remember, Ananias, right? He says, Ananias, I want you to go to pray for this guy, Paul. Ananias then debates, argues might be a little strong, but debates with Jesus. He says, wait a minute, I've heard about this guy. He's killing people. And then Christ, Jesus' response to that is, go your way. He's a chosen vessel unto me. At some point, even if we have objections, God's response is, go. Get to it. Go. And sometimes that's what we need. We just need to go. Not that God won't entertain objections. He does. In Exodus 3 and 4, or in Acts, let's see, would have been 9, Acts 9. You know, he entertains. He's going to reason with us. And he's not, but at some point it's just, go. Yeah. So life lesson, are we as men living like God made us? Oh, what I wanted to mention about this, kind of in sort of in closing here. If you'll take your Bibles and go to Psalm chapter 8. Psalm chapter 8. And let's read it. Psalm 8, yeah. I shouldn't say Psalm chapter 8. You never say Psalm chapter 8. You say Psalm 8. I apologize. It's Psalm 8. And it's Psalm 8. It's not Psalms 8. Psalms as a group of psalms, 150 of them, they're the psalms. If you refer to one, it's Psalm 8 or Psalm 119 or whatever it is. That's the correct way to do that. So in verse 4, of Psalm 8. We'll just read, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, that's the KJV, and hast crowned him with glory and honor. Thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet. Now, you guys have other translations. Do they translate that word angels any other way? Do they say angels? All the babies, all your translations say angels? Because the Hebrew word, I'm not saying that it shouldn't, was that? Does anybody have like a footnote, marginal translation, anything there at all? Got a footnote, shows you down something else in the bottom of the page or anything? No? The Hebrew word there for angels is Elohim. Now that's the word for God. Now it can be also used for angelic messengers, which is the way they translated it here. But the point is, look what that scriptures, those scriptures say. God made, even if you just take angels as the accurate translation, that means God made you a little lower than angels, right? God made you a little lower than angels. Now, does that mean we get haughty about that? Well, no, not at all. The contrast here is, as men of God, as men who are Christians, who are fulfilling a role as man, husband, father, grandfather, elder, deacon, whatever it is, whatever role, or multiple, we have to strike a happy medium between the lofty status God gave us, which he tells us here, and then go to Romans chapter 7. We have to strike the happy medium between these two things. Romans chapter 7. And this is, to me, it's chapter 7, verse 18. This, to me, is a really humbling scripture because the Apostle Paul wrote it, and it's really a humbling scripture. So Romans chapter 7, verse 18, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good I find not. Now, so again, as those multiple roles as men that God has called us to do, right? Whether it's some kind of leader in the church, certainly a leader in your family, a leader of yourself, if nothing else, a leader of your wife. We have to strike a happy mean between, he made us a little lower than the angels. Whoa, look at the opinion God has of you. And in me that is in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. So you've got to remember, God made you great, but you're only great, like that first objection we talked about, you're only great when he's with you. You know, who am I? I will be with you. Who are you? I'll be what I need to be. That's all you got to remember. Just remember that. Who are you? I'm going to be with you. Who am I? I'll be what I need to be. So, are we as men living like God made us, a little lower than the angels? That's what that refers to. I hadn't read Psalm 8 with you yet. And are we pressing toward the prize of the upward calling of God in Christ? I've talked about before the fact that Christianity is supposed to be like a plant. We have a live plant in here, but if you take a live plant and you put it in good soil and you put it in sunlight and you give it water, you can't tell it not to grow. That's not possible. It's not going to happen. As long as it's not pathological, there's not something wrong with it, it's going to grow, right? Christianity is supposed to be like that. We're supposed to be kind of on an upward swing. This, if you go to Philippians chapter 3, Pastor David actually referred to this scripture the other day about the Greek of it. Philippians chapter 3. It's chapter 3, verse 13. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Are we living that way? Are we going toward the upward calling? You know, are we kind of on a constant up here? Because that's what we're supposed to be doing. I mean, it's not like we're going to be climbing Mount Everest one day, but there should be a steady build as Christian men, Christian believers, in whatever role it is that you're fulfilling as a Christian man. Again, this all goes back to Joshua 4:14 with God magnifying Joshua before the people. When he didn't have to do that, he chose to need men. God doesn't need anything. He could do all this without men if he chose to do that, but he has not chosen to do that. He has chosen to need us. So, and I think that's it. Let me pray, and then if you have any questions or concerns, and then Joel, you can, whatever you want to do here. Heavenly Father, thank you for, again, for your word. I pray that we take what your word says and what we learned from it to heart, that we are in earnest about growing consistently as Christians, and especially as Christian men, whom you've called to be men, husbands, fathers, grandfathers, deacons, elders, pastors, or a number of the above. We thank you for your presence with us because it's the only way we can do these things. We thank you that you will be whom you need to be because that's the only way we will do these things. But we also thank you that you have chosen to give us a role to allow us to partake and participate and contribute and even to reward us for doing it. We thank you so very much. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.